So, welcome to the second panel of this Sunday. It's called Beyond Red Lines, Actors in the Syrian Catastrophe. And I'm happy to present to you our distinguished guests and panelists. Starting will be Jonathan Speyer. He will make the first presentation, and Jonathan Speyer is the director at the Rubin Center for Global Research in International Affairs in Jerusalem, and he's a fellow at the Middle East Forum in Philadelphia, United States. He publishes articles on the Middle East in The Guardian, Haaretz, and the Jerusalem Post. As an expert, he's regularly invited by the BBC, Al Jazeera, and CNN. His book, The Transforming Fire, from 2010, investigates the rise of Islamism and has been called the most important book on the situation in the Middle East. He is regularly on the ground in Syria, reports from there in Syria and Iraq, and since 2011 he visits those two countries regularly, and we're happy to hear from him what he has to say from that perspective on the Iranian influence in that realm of Syria and Iraq. The second speaker, and I'm very, very glad to have him here, is Mr. Dr. Mohamad Kamal Allabwani, to my right, to your left. He is a prominent member of the Syrian opposition movement. He works for the Damascus Institute for Research and Studies. He founded the Syrian Liberal Democratic Union and was active in the Damascus Spring Movement in 2000-2001. Dr. Allabwani has been prosecuted and twice imprisoned by the Syrian regime for long-term prison sentences. And I'm glad that he's here today to represent the Syrian opposition. Thank you so much, Dr. Allabwani. And last but not least, our third panelist, to your left, on the very left side, Boris Reitschuster. He is a journalist and an author. He has worked for the German press agencies DPA and AFP in Munich, and became known through his books on contemporary Russia. From 1999 to 2015, he was the head of the Moscow office of the German magazine Focus. Today he works as an author and a publicist in Berlin. Among his publications are Vladimir Putin, Where is Russia Heading? Vladimir Putin, Wo entsteuert Russland? 2004, in German edition was edited. And Putin's Demokratur, How the Kremlin Teaches the West What Fear Is. Putin's Demokratur, Wie der Kreml den Westen das Fürchten lehrt, from 2006, also in German. And the new man in the Kremlin, Dmitry Medvedev, Der neue Herr im Kreml, Dmitry Medvedev, from 2008. He lives in Berlin, and I'm happy to have him here on the panel. Hello, all of you three again. And now we'd like to start with John.
Thanks, Michael. Well, good afternoon, and it's very nice to have the chance to discuss this crucial matters here in this framework. What I'm going to try and do in this talk is to look in some detail at the details and contours of the Iran, or details and patterns, so to speak, of the Iranian support given to the Assad regime over the last 4 years, and to try to ask questions about implications of it and the impact that it's had on the Syrian war. First of all, then, to lay that clear and say, Iranian support, in my estimation, and not only mine, has been a central and crucial factor, if not the central and crucial factor, in enabling the survival of Assad regime in Syria over the last 4 years. And Iranian support has taken three essential forms, which I'll discuss in some detail. Firstly, Assad's main problem in the war throughout has been an absence of manpower, sufficient manpower to support his cause. The regime is based, of course, on a narrow sectarian platform of support. The Alawi community to which the Assad family belong constitutes only around the usual figure, 12% of the country. And so Iran has mobilized regional proxies and assets to plug this gap, and has also, in increasing numbers as the situation has grown more desperate from Assad's point of view, also committed Iranian personnel themselves to the Syrian battlefield to help close that gap. This is firstly. Secondly, Iran has utilized its peerless skill and experience in establishing proxy military forces and in asymmetrical warfare to build new frameworks, new military frameworks for Assad, utilizing Syrian personnel. The National Defense Force, Reitschuster Shabi, is the most famous name, so to speak, in this regard. And thirdly, Iran has been generous in providing financial subsidies to keep the Syrian economy from complete collapse in the course of the last half decade. So we're going to look at all three of these in some detail, but first a little bit of background on the Syrian-Iranian relationship. Well, the relationship between the Syrian and Iranian regimes, you know, was not born on March 15, 2011, the date of the outbreak of the uprising. It's of long-standing, and it is formalized in agreements going all the way back to 1982. Syria was the first Arab country to recognize the provisional government that took power in Iran following the Shah's ouster. And Damascus provided invaluable diplomatic and also military support to Tehran after the Iraq 1980 invasion of the country. And this alliance was formalized in March 1982 in a series of bilateral agreements of oil and trade and a secret pact on military matters, which remains in effect. Without going into immense detail, the relationship has remained close in subsequent decades. In Lebanon in the 1980s, for example, Syrian-Iranian cooperation proved invaluable in frustrating Israeli and US ambitions in the country. Again, joint opposition to Saddam Hussein regime in Iraq was an additional key foundation for the relationship. And indeed, the involvement of both countries in Iraq following the 2003 invasion, though not always in harmony, is an additional notable chapter in the relationship. Not always in harmony, of course, because of the difference of climates in that moment, namely that the Iranians cultivated links, of course, with Shia paramilitary organizations, and the Syrians tended to gravitate towards facilitating the Sunni insurgency. But to sum up this point, you know, in the period prior to 2011, Syria, Assad regime in Syria, a clear and formal ally of Iran. Iran has a goal of the building of a contiguous line of states between its border with Iraq and the Mediterranean Sea. And Syria was and remains an essential component of this ambition. It's worth reiterating also that Iran's main success in its regional outreach program, so to speak, since 1979, has been the creation and building of the Hezbollah Lebanon and the use of that organization against Israel. And Syria plays a vital role in this as a conduit for arms transfers to Hezbollah via Damascus. So the loss of Syria, had it happened, the fall of the Assad regime, had it happened, would have constituted a strategic defeat for the Iranians of major proportions. Regarding then the issue of support of the way that Iran's prevented that unhappy outcome or regrettable post-March 2011 period. First of all, then, the issue I mentioned of Iranian mobilization of regional proxies to aid the Syrian regime. In the early stages of the Syrian uprising, people will remember the opposition took the form of a civilian, unarmed revolt. And Iranian resistance, even at that early stage, was crucial, but it took the form appropriate to the needs of the time. In the initial stages, Iranian assistance consisted of provision of technology, largely of a law enforcement nature, as I say, technology to monitor email, cell phones, social media. These were the days of the Arab Spring, long gone, of course, now, but not so long ago in terms of time. And Iran, of course, has these capabilities well developed in the wake of the 2009 protests in that country. And indeed, if we look into the detail of a series of US Department of Treasury designations, this this situation is reflected. It's Iranian law enforcement forces and officials, along with the Ministry of Intelligence and Security, and the defense contractor, Iran Electronics Industries, are the main players in that initial months in aiding Syrian security institutions in the task of defeating a largely unarmed uprising at that time. And the Treasury Department at that time designated Deputy Commander Brigadier General Ahmed Reza Radan, an official of Iranian law enforcement, for his expertise in aiding the Syrian government's crackdown. Of course, by the end of 2011, the uprising has clearly taken on armed form, and at this point, law enforcement skills begin to lose their relevance, and a different cast of characters begin to be the ones, and a different approach begins to be the one which Iran takes in the same goal of keeping its ally in its place. Again, to reiterate the manpower issue, Syria descends into civil war and the regime faces a dilemma. On paper, Assad has vast armed forces at his disposal, 220,000 regular soldiers of the Syrian Arab Army, an additional 280,000 notionally in the reserves. But in practice, of course, the vast majority of this force cannot be reliably utilized because it consists overwhelmingly of conscripted Sunni Arab Syrians. That is to say, the people coming precisely from the section of society from which the rebellion has emerged. This dilemma, then, is central to the regime's needs, and it chooses to deal with the problem in two ways. Firstly, and very, very importantly to remember, from the summer of 2012, the regime begins to withdraw from areas of the country not deemed essential for regime survival. And in this way, large swathes of northern, eastern, and southern Syria pass out of the control of the regime. I said, to understand the logic of this, manpower is limited, so the regime calculates that it's better to hold on to essential areas rather than to risk losing everything by spreading too thinly. And secondly, the regime begins to benefit from early 2012 onwards from the deployment by the Iranians of proxies on Syrian soil. This is a process, of course, administered by the Revolutionary Guards Corps and its expeditionary Quds force. We can start to trace the arrival of fighters of the Lebanese Hezbollah organization on the Syrian battlefield as early as February 2012. Across the border, initially in from Lebanon, take over 8 villages close to the border, close to the Al-Qusayr area, and they're engaged. And again, as regime fortunes begin to decline in the course of 2012, so that Hezbollah presence begins to expand, and other Iranian proxies begin to become apparent. The regime, it's worth remembering, faced a kind of nadir, a kind of low point, end of 2012. The rebels had pushed into Aleppo, threatened the eastern suburbs of Damascus, and at that point we begin to see an uptick of the presence of Iranian proxy organizations on the ground in Syria. Not only Lebanese Hezbollah, but also Iraqi Shia militias, Qatari Hezbollah, Mahdi Army, and others entering into the Syrian conflict. Ostensibly, perhaps people here remember, the goal is to protect the shrine of Sayyidina Zainab in Damascus, this very important Shia shrine. But in reality, what they're in there for is to plug the gap in manpower that the regime is suffering from. There was an interesting gap in understanding at that time globally. I remember being in Syria in the Aleppo area in the summer of 2012. You spoke and interviewed to rebel fighters at that time. They were already very much aware, and it was the kind of thing you would hear repeated again and again, that Hezbollah was there, and they went, "He's for shaitan." Party of Satan, they call it, rather than the party of God. But at the time, if you raised that issue in international forums, as I would occasionally try to do, people would say, no, this is just typically the Israelis again trying to make out that the Iranians are behind everything. So for a while, there was a gap between reality and perception, which of course later on was narrowed and eventually disappeared. It disappeared because the extent of IRGC involvement in Syria and of the presence of militias began to be so apparent that it was impossible to subsequently deny. And we remember the killing of the Iranian Brigadier General Hassan Shatter in Damascus countryside in February 2013 as a defining moment to that increasingly obvious visibility of the Iranians on the ground in Syria. Shapir had been operating, you know, in Syria and Lebanon since 2006, but his killing became a sort of marking point of the increasing awareness in that regard. The other reason why things were becoming more and more visible is because Assad's situation was growing more and more desperate, and as he did so it became impossible to conceal the very volume of Iranian proxies that were on the ground. And we hear at least that in early 2013, at Nadir, Assad asked the Iranians for further support, and Iran then demanded from Hezbollah a greater commitment into the country. And since then, the usual figure given is a constant presence of around 10,000 Hezbollah fighters in the country, resulting in heavy losses for the movement. The Iraqi component comes and goes. It got bigger, but then it was largely withdrawn in the summer of 2014 when ISIS swept into Iraq. And since then, it has in part returned. And in the course of 2015, of this year, as regime fortunes continue to decline, so the extent of Iranian help continues to increase, and we begin to see in the course of this year a growing presence of Iranians themselves in frontline combat. In the spring and summer of 2015, the Saudi, Qatari, and Turkish-supported Jaish al-Fatah rebel coalition begins to make real inroads into the northwest of the country, threatening for the first time the integrity of the regime enclave in the western coastal area. And it is against that background that we should understand the reported, at least, visit of General Qasem Soleimani to Moscow in July with the intention of putting together a very major commitment to prevent further rebel advances into the west. Of course, Russian air assets were subsequently deployed in September of this year, but it's crucial to remember that the force on the ground that the Russian aircraft are engaging together with is one put together not by the Russians, not by Assad, but by the Iranians. Recent reports in a Kuwaiti newspaper, Al-Rai, go into detail, ostensibly at least, of the numbers involved. And according to the newspaper, 2,000 members of the IRGC itself, Iranian fighters, are there, arriving in Latakia, entering the field of battle, along with 2,000 Iraqi Shia militiamen from Hezbollah once again, 2,000 Afghan Shia fighters from the Diwa al-Fatimiyun. It's interesting to note that as the situation grows more desperate from a manpower point of view from Assad, so the presence of foreign fighters becomes more and more exotic. It's not only just Syrians and Lebanese anymore, it's Afghan Shia, even also Pakistani Shia starting to be noticed on the ground. The man in charge of all this was once again General Qasem Soleimani. I could go into more detail about the makeup of the fighters and the specific names of the militias. I can do that if people are interested, but I guess in terms of, for reasons of time, I'll jump ahead and just say that the bottom line with regard to this first question is that, you know, insufficient manpower has been the key problem facing the Assad regime from the beginning, and the Iranians have been willing to step in to plug the gap, and as the regime's fortunes have worsened, so the amount of help has increased, up to and including now a large presence of Iranians themselves. The Iranians have been willing to pay the price, and they're likely to continue to be willing to do so. The second issue I mentioned in terms of Iranian, the shape of Iranian support, was the creation of local forces in Syria, and the third was the provision of weapons. So let me just look at those briefly before concluding. Alawi paramilitaries played an important part in the attempt to suppress the revolt, the so-called Shapika, if people remember that term from the early days, right from the start. In early 2012, and throughout the course of that year, in desperate shape, short of manpower, Assad acquiesces to the Iranian suggestion of turning these forces into an organized, nationally commanded auxiliary force, the so-called National Defense Force, or Jaish al-Shaabi. And once again, the creation of this force, personally overseen by Qasem Soleimani, both playing a key role in the formalization of this NDF along the model of the Iranian Basij militia. Ruel Margaret in his talk mentioned this process and said it and correctly pointed out it's a key moment in terms of Assad's surrender in a certain sense to the Iranian agenda. We know how the Iranians do this, and Assad knows it too. They create militias for you, but they don't then hand over the keys of those militias to your control. They're under Iranian control, not Assad's control. Same as in Iraq, Hashtashabi, the Shia militia force, the same as in Lebanon. So Assad has no choice, nevertheless, and he acquiesces to this process, in which Iran essentially gathers existing neighborhood militias, provides them with a functioning hierarchy, with better equipment, with better training, and creates them into a serious military force. Jaish al-Shaabi provided with funding worth millions of dollars, and numbering today close to around 100,000 men, and playing a crucial role in combat on behalf of the regime. What then of the third issue I mentioned, weapons, provision, and financial aid? Important to understand, the Syrian economy has effectively ceased to function since 2011. Assad's government is almost entirely dependent on loans and gifts from Iran and from the Russian Federation. Recent economic studies by the UN, by the IMF, paint a grim picture. Gross domestic product, half of what it was 3 years ground production effectively ground to a halt, inflation of 50%, exports and imports down by 90%, unemployment of 50%, and so on and so forth. Once again, Iranian generosity has been crucial to Assad's survival. Iran does not, of course, release official figures regarding its financial assistance to Assad. And so the estimates of analysts vary. Stefan de Mistura, the UN Special Envoy, estimated that Iran spends $6 billion annually on Assad's government. Independent analysts have higher figures. Nadim Chade, a respected Lebanese analyst, says his research shows Iran spent between $14 and $15 billion in military and economic aid to the Damascus regime in 2012 and 2013. Stephen Hayman, another respected observer of the situation, estimates total support between $15 and $20 billion annually. This is not a chump change. Even if it's only 6 billion, it's a very, very significant commitment indeed. This injection of funding has once again been an essential lifeline for the Assad regime. The bottom line of the figures I gave a minute ago are that Assad doesn't possess a functioning economy. He is today in the position, essentially, of a recipient of gifts from the Islamic Republic of Iran. And provision of weapons, of course, too, a crucial part of the commitment to the regime war effort. The air corridor over Iraq to Damascus, the most vital means of transport of weaponry for the regime. Armed shipments, often using Iranian commercial airlines, a vital conduit in this regard. This goes back to before the uprising, by the way. Damascus is the main hub for the supply of Hezbollah. To move towards conclusion then, let me say the following points. All this adds up to a general mobilization. A 4 year standing, by Islamic Republic of Iran, at a time when it was under, for a period at least, very, very serious international sanctions, with the intention of achieving, by all means necessary, the preservation of the rule of the Assad regime in Syria. If not in the whole of the country, and this is the crucial point I wish to emphasize by way of conclusion, then at least in the parts deemed vital by Tehran. What's the scorecard? How are they doing after 4 years of this great effort that I've been describing. First of all, let's not be Iranians on the lines on that game. Maybe it is. If it is, I'm also now. What's the scorecard? The scorecard is one of partial success. Not strategic victory, but partial success. What does that mean? It means that the mobilization has succeeded in a way typical of Iranian interventions elsewhere in the region, in part. In the following way, Iranian help has not been sufficient to completely overcome the inherent weaknesses and limitations of the Assad regime. Sorry about
this. It's the Russians, though.
It's the Russians. If it's them, then I'm really in trouble. The Iranians should be more. Iranian help has not been sufficient to overcome these weaknesses and limitations in order to deliver a strategic victory for Assad. This is a crucial point. What would strategic victory mean? It would mean the reuniting of the country under Assad's control, the destruction of the rebel, and Kurdish, and Islamic State entities, and the restoration of the status quo ante bellum. The narrow sectarian base of the regime, the tenacity of the rebels, and the assistance afforded the latter by Sunni states and to a lesser extent by the West, have been sufficient to prevent this strategic victory. At the same time, Iranian assistance has proven sufficient to keep Assad in the fight and to prevent his defeat. This, it seems to me, resembles similar patterns vis-a-vis Iranian clients elsewhere in Yemen, in Iraq, in Lebanon, and among the Palestinians. As such, Iranian interference in Syria and in the regional outreach more generally should be seen, in my view, as a symptom of a larger process of state breakdown and sectarian conflict, which characterizes the current Middle East. The Iranians and their regional outreach in Syria and elsewhere are essential players in this larger conflict, but the nature of their aims and their methods serve to exacerbate conflict without as yet delivering strategic victory for Iran in any area, including Syria, because, in my estimation, of the relative strength of the Sunni enemies of Iran and the limitations of Iran's own strength and that of its clients. That's to say, and this is my concluding sentence, the Iranians have prevented the victory of their enemies without yet producing victory for their friends. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jonathan Spire. Now I want to welcome Mr. Allabwani to present us his views.
Thank you.
As you know, Syria is the middle of the world. The conflict in it summarizes that world's competition is so high and afraid that Syria will be the strike of another world war. When the people try to get their freedom, the totalitarian corrupt regime fills them by cruel sectarian violence, which speed up the growth of Islamic groups. Islamic groups had support also from neighbors and Gulf states who afraid the freedom to lick their doors. The Syrian people divided between whom continue supporting the revolution. Whom support the revolution, I mean poor Arab Sunni, especially in the village and shanty towns. And whom obliged to stay with the regime, I mean Alawis and minorities, so the rich corrupt class. But the majority trying to escape the conflict by keeping silent or leaving the country. After that, this similar picture had complexed by the outside intervention, especially of Hezbollah and Iran, which invite directly and indirectly the most fanatic international jihadists and covered the fact by a lot of lies and deceivers. Now it gets hard to understand the situation, not only because a lot of distortion done by ideological propagandas, but also because the huge political investment and external intervention. When we look to the map and the fronts, we will misunderstand the reality. Amman, as example, usually the most fanatic Sunni city, is still with the regime. Damascus, part of Aleppo, it is not because it supports the regime. Also, Al-Raqqa and Deir Zor, it does not support ISIS. Lot of Alawis whom now support the regime, they do because they have no another option. Idlib and Homs was not a land of fanatic jihadists. In general, we can say Syria now under the occupation of the gangs. The regime, Iranian militia, the ISIS, and the other international jihadists also. The shape of military organization is not stable. It moves with the resources of support. So no meaning to the maps or names and statistics. Because the situation is always deceiving and changing. So any study would be wrong just by time. The Syrian needs, the people Syria needs, like any other people needs. But whom prevented it, and how, and who, and how, that would define the reaction of the people. The violence, for example, the violence sub-oppression creates the local armed groups named FSA, Official Party. It was the most majority of the fighters at the beginning. But sectarian behavior of the regime creates sectarian Islamic jihadists. The Iranian intervention encouraged the Saudi Arabia and Turkey. Russian assault unifies the groups now under the flag of Al-Qaeda. Then the situation expresses the reaction, but the main actors tell the regime who assumes all responsibility, whom still constantly is the will of the regime to continue fighting by all means, and also the will of the people to be free and independent. In Syria, the regime depends on big army and armed securities, also militias related to the Ba'ath Party, called public militia. The regime also gets used to compose and cooperate with gangs supposed to be an enemy, to do anything he wants without responsibility. Some of them is Islamic jihadists, as ISIS, Palestine as Fatah al-Islam, Kurd as PKK, Shia as Hezbollah, Alawi al-Shabiha, also Druze. The regime looked like a director of gangs in Syria. So the fail of Syrian state is not a new one. The fail in establishing patriot political system and the role of law is old. It is not because the revolution, which has only one aim, knocking down the walls of the prison, Ash'ab, Yurid, Iskata, Nizam. We cannot define sectarian militia independent from the regime, in the minorities. Also, the Sunni jihadists became sectarian in reaction with the regime sectarian massacre. So the main conflict in Syria is between the regime and the people. And any initiative for peace to do not regard this will fail and will only prolong the conflict as happened last weeks in Vienna. The military opposition groups composed from two main parts. Local military groups, it is not ideologic, free army, classified as moderate because it is independent, patriot, not ideology. So because of that, it complained the lack of organization and the lack of support. Nobody supported. The external support till now goes to the Islamists, which very welcome in Turkey and other states. Till now, rule the coalition, which caused the opposition coalition, and the out government, and hold the institutes of the opposition, the Islamist parties. The second part of the opposition groups is ideological jihadist groups which have good indirect support from outside or have own resources. Also, it behaves as a state or emirate of war. All of it are fanatic, violent, using terrorism, but also defense the people from the regime itself. I mean Jabhat al-Nusra and its sisters, Jaysh al-Fatah, al-Jabhat al-Shamiya, Jaysh al-Islam, Ahrar al-Sham. All of this is fanatic and able to commit terrorists. But Daesh is different. It's more independent, more violent against the people of Syria. It came from Iraq. Behave as incubation forces in Syria, as the same as Hezbollah and Shia militia, PKK, and the similar groups. We till now still suspect Daesh is directed by the regime and the Iranian regime. To classify the members of these fanatic groups, I mean only the fanatic groups, because the local militia now exists or not exist, but I think it is local and volunteer, it's not well organized. But to classify the ideological jihadist group, we have three classes. 10% of them, the members, I think, not the organization, the members inside them. 10% who refuse to fight under any flag else this flag. Most of them coming from outside. 30% whom accept to live in special condition, maybe have logistic support, for example. These 30% represent the Syrian fanatics. Half of them get fanatic, not he was fanatic. He get fanatic recently because the massacre and the war. The majority, 60%, whom obliged to work with the jihadists and waiting the time to leave it because they had separate aims, represent the moderate who would change their loyalty because the urgent needs and conditions. So when we speak about jihadists, we have not speak about all. The majority of them became jihadists and we can withdraw them from their position. Regarding that, in South, the situation is different. Just because the influence of Jordan and Israel. So I have visited Israel and still encourage them and Jordan to continue helping in the South. When we search for moderate opposition, we have to regard the totally loss of the Syrian society. Politically, structure and institution, civil society. Because the huge war, occupation, immigration and displacement, and also fake representation. So nobody can find legal or acceptable representation for Syria now. It needs long-term investing in administration and organization. Instead of that, the regional influence and support will help finally the fanatic ideology. We don't look to the people of Syria and depend on them, useless. All in all, it is not Syria. The Alawis is not the regime. The Shia is not Hezbollah. Kurd is not PKK. And Sunni is not Al-Qaeda or ISIS. All of these are the result of the problem. Real Syria could be seen only in the sieges inside, the camps refugee outside. Syrian people like me find themselves dismissed out their homes and case. The funny coalition represents the international security agencies and the money resources. So it keeps conflicting and dividing by two parts, gas for Qatar and oil for Saudi. The jihadist group also do not represent the will of the Syrian. And of course, the criminal tyranny regime don't represent them. Whom think we have to let the fanatic exhaust each other, do not regard that they get more powerful and more spread and influence by the time. Whom exhausting is the humanity, the societies, and our missiles and security. The widespread of ignorance and corruption, the absence of any law authorities and the control exaggerate criminal and cruel culture, especially in a new generation. All of this makes the time against us, plus the huge humanitarian crisis. No any magic total solution now can be made in Geneva or Vienna. No mean to use the criminals as the regime and others for establishing justice. We need to make justice by criminals. No wisdom in recycling the regime and the multi-corrupt opposition. We need to start from different areas and rebuild the new example and support it to expand in all the area. It is very important to create the zone in south and north and help the people to return and reinstall their own lovely Syria. So the whole of the region, in a very new way, out of the criminals and the crimes, depending on the people, not the foreign armies, using power of life, not the power for death. It is the only thing which let us say the blood of Syria will not cheat. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Allabwani. Now it's time for Boris Reitschuster to present us the Russian intervention and the implication that he has done in Syria. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm just back from a journey throughout Germany with speeches and meetings, and I'm quite shocked about the lack of knowledge and the lack of understanding about Russia. You know, the day before yesterday, I had a meeting with a former colonel from the German Ministry of Defense, who is now an international professional for Eastern Europe and security, and he made a long speech about how to balance the strategic interests with Putin. He spoke long about how to avoid to get a new front line in Europe. And I said to him, we have a front line in Europe already. How do we want to avoid it when we are in the middle of a war in Eastern Ukraine? It's not stopped yet. And his first answer was, oh, you get polemic. I said, it's not me getting polemic. We have a war inside Europe, and you're speaking like nothing is happening. And if I see this, if I see many of our analysts, our professionals, you know, I make one picture. They all trying to understand Putin as if he would play chess. They're thinking when he moves with his queen, they're thinking, does he want to go to A2, B3, C4? Is he starting an attack on our queen side? But Putin isn't playing chess. Putin is playing some Russian variation of chess. It's so-called Chapayev. And Chapayev is when you use the chess pieces as weapons, when you fight with them. And so if he takes with his hands the green, we should not think only about A3, B4, C6. We should think about maybe he will beat us up the head with his fingers, you know? And this stupidness, it drives me really crazy after 16 years living in Russia and really understanding something of this psychology. It's really incredible how naive we can be in the West. What is Putin's aim in Syria? It has many aims. First of all, what is the main source of income for Putin? Main source of Russian budget? It's selling gas and oil. So what's existential for his income? It's oil price. So I ask you, what do you know it, I don't have to ask you. When the oil price is high and when the oil price is low, if you have stability in the Middle East, the oil price is low and Putin gets less money. So what's his natural interest? I think you don't have to be a master of economics, of mathematics to understand this, and I wonder why so many of our politicians do not understand this. So you always take it for granted that Putin is interested in stability in the Middle East. My thesis is the opposite. And if you have a look at Putin's politics for 15 years, he's always fishing in troubled waters. Always. He's nearly always putting oil on the fire. And he does this in Syria for many years, for 3 years already. You know? He was the one who blocked the veto in the United Nations against the using of mass destruction weapons. always backing Assad. He's helping with weapons, and he was one of the main players who tried to avoid any solution in Syria. And of course, he was assisted very well and very effectively by Obama, because Obama created, in my opinion, a vacuum with his red line, which he drew and didn't stand up for, if you remember this. And so for Putin's situation he has now, it's ideally he will be very happy about what's going on. And what are his main goals? One of his main goals is, for inner reasons inside Russia, it makes him much more popular that he can now tell again, see our politics, we are superpower again, we are back on the world stage, we are necessary for everyone. And if you have a look at the Russian television, you will see it's like some heroic epos about Putin getting back Russia to the international stage. And he really did this. And he did this because of the, in many points, because of the weakness of our policy, because of the weakness of our leaders. What are his other main aims in Syria? Of course, he's interested in holding his bases, military bases over there in the Middle East, about holding his influence there in the Middle East. And I would even go one step farther and would say that one of his main goals is to get something like the patron, the backing power for tyrants, for dictators, because if he will succeed in backing up Assad, it's quite a sign, it's quite symbolic to the other mass murderers under the guards of our world. It's a sign, just be with Putin. Just be on my side, and I will help you against these Americans, against these Europeans. You don't have to be afraid of Den Haag or of getting to trial. You just will be on the side of Russia. I can defend you. And I think the other dictators in this world, they have a very close look on what's going on in Syria, and it will be very, very important for the further development of war politics, whether he will succeed or whether he will not succeed in getting the pattern of dictators. And if you have a look, you see he's already now, he's always in friendship with the bad guys. North Korea, Iran, you spoke about Khaled Soleimani's visit to Moscow. We don't know it for fact, but knowing Putin, I would be rather surprised if Soleimani would not have been in Moscow then if he would have been, because from the logic of Putin's system, it makes absolute sense that he has been in Moscow and that they are cooperating with Iran. They cooperate with Iran for years. It's very close. And it shows how bad Putin is as a strategist. He's only a tactician, because for strategic reason, Iran is dangerous for Russia. Especially, it's dangerous for Russia if Iran really has atomic weapons, nuclear weapons, because it's very close. If you have a look on the map, you see that Russia should be well aware of instability on the south about nuclear weapons in Iran. But Putin always looks for the next day, and he doesn't look for the big picture, what's going on in 10 years. And one very important thing we underestimate in Western politics and Western analysis of Russia, you always think Putin wants to do what's best for Russia. I'm deeply convinced that that's not the point. Putin wants to do what's good for the small group of ruling people who have the wealth of Russia and who exploit this country and who exploit the richness of this country and who try to get out so much money as possible from this country to Switzerland, to Germany, and all over the West. So one other point is for Putin that, if you know, there are quite a lot of Chechen and Caucasian fighters inside the Islamic State. And the very strange point, which you can only understand if you know how strange FSB, the Russian Secret Service, the former KGB, is working, is that on the one hand we have some cooperation between Russia and Islamic State, even through former connections with Iraq, which was very close to Russia, and we have some informal connections. And the security sources say even that Islamic State gave up the coordinates, the position of some Islamic fighter in the Caucasus region to the Russians, because they were common enemies. And so Moscow plays really a double game with the Islamic State, but they are very, very happy that with this war in Syria, many fighters from the Caucasian region are now in Syria. And so they are deflected from Russia, and so that's one more reason why Russia has to be afraid of peace in Syria, because the thousands of Islamic fighters from the south of Russia would tend to come back into Russia. So he's really interested in getting back. How should we deal with that? I'm very unhappy. I think in Germany now we have too much Gerhard Schröder, you know what I mean? Former chancellor who's now working for Gazprom and is always on the side of Putin. And our foreign minister Steinmeier is something in this tradition. Even our minister of economics, Gabriel, he was to a visit to Moscow for a meeting Putin. And my impression was it was a job interview for Gazprom, you know, and not straight foreign policy. And I would like to have less Schröder and more Helmut Schmidt and more Konrad Adenauer. Because we had the history of the so-called NATO Doppelbeschluss. It's, how do you say it in English? NATO twice...
Double track decision.
How?
Double track decision.
Double track decision. It was when we said either Russia will withdraw this kind of weapons, or we will arm ourselves, and we should do something like this with Ukraine. We should say either Russia closes his border, either we will support Ukraine with defensive weapons. And one of my main goals of Putin in Syria, for sure, is to get some pledge for Ukraine. Because I think he wants some deal. But I help you a little bit. Today I won't be the arsonist for one day, I won't be the firefighter for one day, and so recognize the criminal occupation. And I'm sure that he has in mind some party like this. And we should not go with this. And we should understand, you know, we always think if you tell it in computer language, we think Putin is working on the same operation system as we, Windows 10 or 8. But Putin has another operation system. Former German Democratic Republic, the Communist part of Germany, made some strange attempts of building computer devices, and the result was Robotron. It's like a calculator. And Putin still in many attitudes works with this operation system. He has the values, values is the wrong word. Yes, the imaginations of politics are still from the 19th century. You know, it's always about possession, attacking other countries, aggression, and not about cooperation, and not about finding some common way. And of course we should buy with him, of course we have to speak with him, but we have to keep this in mind. We have to be less naive. We have to know which, with whom we are dealing. And if we had this naivety 50 years ago, the Berlin Wall, which was quite 100 meters about here, you know, it would be in the history, not as the Berlin Wall, it would be in the history as the anti-fascistic defending building, that it was called from German, from communist propaganda. And let me finish with this one sentence. The reaction to the terror in Paris made me really sad, because what was the reaction if you say it very provocative? We had 130 people dying in Paris. The reaction was to ask for help for a man who's responsible for thousands of deaths in Ukraine, that he will back up a man who's responsible for 100,000 of deaths in Syria. That's some kind of schizophrenia. Thank you very much.